Hello everyone, my name is Hailey Elizabeth, and if you don't know who I am, I post videos pertaining a little bit of everything. Conspiracy theories, true crime, controversial people, a little bit of new stuff in the future as well. Vlogs and things like that.
All things spooky, scary skeletons. I forgot to say it.
So if you're interested in any of that, you can subscribe. And if not, totally chill, totally cool. Let's relax. Let's hang out. We're going to be talking about Ed Gein today, the man that wore his victims' bodies. But before we get into this video, I do want to apologize for not posting last week. Last week was a mess. I feel like everyone is super sad right now. I don't know what it is. Maybe it's the air, but every person that I've talked to, they're like, yeah, I'm not feeling 10 right now. It has not been my week or anyone else's week, but you know what? It's Friday, baby. That means it's the start of a new week in 2 days. We could turn this party upside down still. We can still get this party started. The day that I'm recording this is on Halloween. I don't know if you could see that. Happy Halloween, even though I'm posting this on like November 5th. I don't want to bore you any longer, so let's just hop right into it. Before we get into the rest of today's video, I do want to give a big thank you to Karma for sponsoring today's video. And now if you don't know what Karma is an app/Chrome extension that'll make sure that you never miss another coupon code, another restock, or a price drop on any of your favorite items. A lot of you guys know in the month of October, I decided to dress up and do a little spooky, scary outfit for every single video. And a little fun fact, I actually used Karma in order to get them. Karma is honestly so helpful and so easy. And right now I'm actually going to show you how to use Karma and show you how easy it is to use. As you can see, installing Karma is so easy. Look at that, just like a few clicks and we're done. Wow, beautiful. That was fast, actually. So we'll use this blazer for an example because, girl, $200. Yeah, no, we don't got the time or money for that. So I'm gonna save this item. Let's do medium. And then any price change. And then we can add a little clothing. And there you go. And product updated. Just like that, anytime this product that I have been keeping my eye on for the longest time restocks, has a price change, or Karma has a coupon code, it will then send me a notification via email or my mobile phone. And another really cool thing about Karma is you can separate your likings into lists. So I have clothing and makeup. Basically, Karma just eliminates all buyer's remorse. Say you like have been looking on something and then a week later it goes on sale, which you weren't aware it was on sale. And now you got a little bit of buyer's remorse because you're like, dang, I could have gotten this so much cheaper than what I'm buying it at right now. Thanks to Karma, you will no longer have that issue. And Karma automatically scans the web for coupon codes at checkout. And this is a special feature if you use Karma on your computer. So the web extension is a must. And another really cool feature that Karma has is their 2% cash back. Karma will give you a 2% cash back of Fenn's, Browns, Paul Frederick, like literally all these designer brands. Bed Bath & Beyond, are you kidding me? More like Bed Bath & Be On My Bed, because I'm about to get some with Karma. Maybe it's a makeup product, a clothing product, an electronic. If you have been eyeing something for a pretty long time and you're waiting for that price to drop or a coupon code to come up, you don't have to sit there in front of your computer and wait no longer, because Karma is here to help you. And if you guys want to get Karma for yourself, use the link down below. And thank you so much to Karma again for sponsoring today's video. Now, with that being said, take it back to your video. Yes, there is like nothing up there. It does look super plain. If any of you interior design baddies want to like comment down below of what I should do with this wall, that'd be beautiful. Edward Theodore Gein was born on August 27th, 1906 in La Crosse, Wisconsin. He was born into his mother, father, and older brother, Henry. Now, a little bit of backstory on his mother and father. His father grew up as an orphan. He actually watched both of his parents, including his sister, drowned in a massive flood at just 3 years old. So he ended up having to go into an orphanage. Because of all of this, he grew very, very depressed, leading him into alcoholism when he was just 15 years old. He was just so young and he refused help from anyone else. So this followed him all the way into adulthood. As for the mother was extremely strict. She was very dominant, very, very religious, kind of like the principal from Matilda, that sort of strict, like abusively strict. In 1902, that's when they had their first son, Henry. But since their first son, Henry, was a son and not a daughter, she thought that like, oh, the only reason I can't bond with my child is because it's a boy and I want a girl. I feel like I'd bond better with a girl. So all throughout the pregnancy, when the mother was like pregnant with Ed, she was actually praying to God every single night that it would be a girl because she just wanted a girl so, so bad. In 1906, that is when they had Ed. Ed came out a boy and not a girl. At first, the mother was very, very like mad about this because of course she wanted a girl, but instead she got two boys. But after a while, she just started to come around to the fact and realized like, hey, God did this for a reason. I'm just gonna raise my two boys to be the most perfect and respectable sons. This was another thing about her, is that since she was so strict, she hated literally all men and women besides herself and like her kids. She just felt like everyone was a sinner besides her. Any woman that is unmarried is like trash, basically. So since she thought all men were just slimy pigs and so were all women, she decided to take her two boys and raise them and kind of like mold them and brainwash them into being the perfect men in her eyes, force them to believe all of her crazy ideologies. They are so young, they can't really have a say in anything. So then about 8 years later, that is when the mother actually decided that she does not like La Crosse, Wisconsin anymore. She feels like the whole town has just gone to sin. There are so many sinners everywhere she looks and she can't even stand to walk out of the house anymore. So they decided to move up to rural farmland. So they basically just got a house in the absolute middle of nowhere. So this way she didn't have to deal with any of the outside public unless she chose to. And her boys were also more easier to control because she doesn't have to worry about them going out into the streets and meeting sinners. Literally, these boys were just so, not like held captive against their will. They had just been kind of brainwashed to think like, why would I need to go anywhere else if everything that I've ever wanted is at home? The only time the boys would ever leave the house was to go to school. Even when they went to school, they were very scared to talk to anyone because their mother had just taught them all their lives that like the world is bad and you should be scared. And so they were scared. They were like, girl, I don't want to be here anymore. Because of this, the boys being extremely quiet and not saying much, this kind of opened the floor for a lot of bullying. Especially Ed would be bullied because Eddie was like the younger one, so he was kind of getting picked on, and Henry was getting picked on as well. Ed didn't really like mind it at all because again, they had really no contact with the outside world. Everything in life was just so foreign to them outside of what their mother was speaking to them. And not to even mention that like the abusive connection that they had with their mother, since like the mother was so strict and so hard on, it was very hard for them to get any love or affection from anyone because they weren't really getting it from their mother and they were getting abused by their father. I didn't even mention this, but when the father would get drunk, he would frequently abuse the kids and the wife. But since the wife was just so religious, she did not believe in divorce, so she just kind of put up with it. In Ed's perspective, deep down, like, Ed just didn't really like his mother. On the outside, he really loved his mother. He, you know, tried to win her approval with everything that he could. He would try to get the best grades, he would try to be the most hardworking, but it's like everything that he did was never enough for her. So deep down, he really did resent her for that, but he just never showed it. Ed, at the age of 14, decided to drop out of school in order to help around the farmhouse house, and so that's exactly what he did. Now, Ed specifically was in complete isolation. Now that Ed wasn't going to school anymore at just 14 years old, he had no connection with the outside world. The only time he would talk to someone would be his family, and that was it. Like, he would barely ever go into town to buy stuff. That was mostly something that his mother did. In the early 30s, that is when Ed and his brother decided to take on odd jobs together. This is how they got their money for not only themselves, but also for the household. They were just given all these responsibilities at such a young age that they really didn't need to have. The father ended up falling very ill because of his alcoholism and actually died in 1940. You would think that like people would be sad that their father died, but actually quite the opposite. The mother and the brothers were both very relieved to have their father die, as messed up as that sounds. It's mostly because all the father did was drink, yell, and hit. Like, he didn't really play the role as both a father and a husband. A lot of people believe that possibly the only reason the mother really married the father was because she felt like she could like fix him, or that she just really, really wanted children. No one was really sad about this. It was just like, oh, he's dead? Oh no! That was the family. Henry, the oldest brother, so since the father wasn't around anymore, Henry kind of stepped up to be like the man of the house. So he would frequently go into town to buy groceries and wood and different types of things that they needed for the house. And he actually started to meet with this single mother. And this woman was the very first organic woman contact that he's ever had, besides through his mother or like girls through school. He had never met a woman organically before, and so it was very big and like kind of a shock to him. He started actually dating this girl, and as he started to date this girl, he started to realize all of the abusive tendencies of his mother. His mother was absolutely so far gone. Like, her ideologies about life, the way that she taught things, thought about things, the way that she put them into total isolation up until their 30s and not even like allowing them to go out and live a life. He started to realize how toxic the household was, because this woman was like, yeah, that's not normal for your mom to like force you to stay home until you're 30 years old just so you could like do work for her. So through this, he just started to not really put up with his mother's stuff anymore. Stick up for himself whenever she would yell. He would stick up for Ed whenever she would yell at Ed. As for Ed, he did not feel the same way as Henry. He still really, really worshipped his mother. I think it's because Ed was still kind of looking for that validation from her. Henry would make fun of Ed for this and call him a mama's boy and a suck up. Don't you ever, you know, want to go out there and live a life of your own? But since Ed was just so brainwashed by the mother, he just kind of saw Henry as like the villain in this situation. He felt like it was really wrong of Henry to be disrespecting their mother. Henry would also tend to like talk bad about the mother behind the mother's back to Ed. Mom did this today and it's really frustrating and I don't understand. Treats us like this, da 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 da, and just complain about the mother and calling her just like bad names and stuff like that, which Ed was not having it. One day, Ed and Henry, this is the alleged story that Ed gives. Ed and Henry were outside, and when they were doing some yard work, they had a fire going. So all of a sudden, the fire spread. Immediately when this happened, Ed ran off of the farm and into the city to go get help from the fire station or the police. And when they came back, Ed led them directly to Henry's body, dead in the middle of the field. Oh, well, he probably just died in the fire. But the weird thing about it is that Henry's body had absolutely no burns onto him. Have like a few wounds on his head, as if hitting him over the head with something. A lot of people just saw this as very odd. odd that, like, why would Ed directly lead them to the dead body in the middle of, like, a huge fire? Why wouldn't he wait till the fire is done with? Didn't really look too deep into this, weirdly. They just kind of assumed it was an accident and said Henry was probably doing his thing and then accidentally hit his head, knocked himself out, and then when he knocked himself out, the fire was going, and then he passed out because of the fumes from the fire. That was the ruling for the cause of death. They actually never did an autopsy on the body. The whole town knew about the family, although they were isolated because, as I said, the brothers would often take up odd jobs. They were labeled as, like, super hardworking, super respected, well-behaved. They had, like, a good reputation in town, so the whole town was really, really devastated to hear about what happened to Henry. Months later, the mother actually suffered from a stroke. It left her, like, partially paralyzed, so she couldn't really do a lot of things on her own. And even though Ed had basically nursed her back to health, not once did the mother show him any sort of gratitude for what he was doing. She was just kind of like, well, of course you're helping me because I'm your mother. Why else wouldn't you be helping me? Well, if I'm sick, obviously you're gonna take care of me. So why would I thank you for that? Like, thank you for doing your job. That's not something to be grateful for. That's something to be expected. And that was just, like, her attitude towards it. So Ed practically nursed her back to health until she was able to, like, walk around and be her old self again. Never once did he receive any gratitude, sign of being thankful for what he had just done to, like, help her. Again, like, it was just that need for that validation and approval, which he never got. A month after that, Ed and the mom go out to another farmer's house to pick up some supplies for their farm. I think after, like, reading a few articles about this, Ed and the mom went to this farm to pick up some supplies, and then when they got there, the dog that was on the farm kept on barking at Ed and his mother, and so due to him constantly barking, the farmer ended up just, like, beating or abusing the dog. And then because of this, a woman who, like, was just, like, a woman staying at the house, she ran out of the farmhouse and tried to, like, yell at the farmer to stop abusing the family dog. And the mother, remember how I told you how, like, the mother hates men and women, like, so very much, especially unmarried women? So this unmarried woman runs out of the house, and the mother's response to this unmarried woman running out of the house is complete shock and disgust and despair. And she starts yelling at the woman and, like, calling her names to the point where she has another stroke. This woman hated other women so much that it sent her into another stroke. And she ended up dying from it. She ended up dying from having another stroke just at the sight of another woman. I won't make any jokes because someone died. I'm just saying that's a lot. Yeah, she died on December 29th of 1945. And of course, since Ed, literally all of Ed's life, all he ever knew was his mother. Ideologies, how she ran things, what she did, it was all through his mother. So now that Ed did not have his mother anymore, it sent him into a very spiraling depression to the point where he would not walk anywhere in the house besides the kitchen and his bedroom beside the kitchen. If you guys watched my Brenda Spencer video, that's, like, a very common thing when people are going through grief. They tend to keep the house the same exact was as when the person left. It's more of, like, a coping thing. Even in just these two rooms that he confined himself into, they got extremely dirty. They looked like a hoarder's room. As time went on, things got a lot better, and Ed started to actually go into town a lot more, into, like, the shops and the taverns. And there was this one specific tavern that he would frequently go to. If you don't know what a tavern is, it's basically like a bar and grill. They have, like, a bar so you could drink, but they also have, like, tables so you can eat food. And this one specific one that was owned by this woman named Mary Hogan. So Mary Hogan actually looked a lot like Ed's mother, and that's why a lot of people believe that is the reason why Ed loved this woman so much. Very dominant, very pushy, knew what she wanted. She also was like around the same height and build as his mother. Every time he would go in there, you know, Ed not really having much connection with the outside world, he didn't really know what was socially accepted and what wasn't. He would just go into the tavern and just stare at her all day, and like, of course this made her very uncomfortable, but Ed's intention wasn't to make her uncomfortable. He just liked her beauty, so he stared at her. He didn't really think that that was a weird thing, since, as I said earlier, the whole town was aware of the boys' situation. They would kind of come into town to like work and do odd jobs, so Mary knew Ed's story. His entire life he was isolated with his mother and his brother, and now his mother and his brother are gone, so he has no choice but to kind of raise himself now. So Mary understood that and was like, okay, well, it's fine if he hangs out here, just as long as he's not like causing trouble. What's the harm in it? As time went on, again, he just started to feel a lot better. He actually started to pick up on a few hobbies, read things such as magazines and comic books. But a really like odd thing that Ed would do as well is that he would frequently get books that talked about true crime and horror, and he would also read the newspaper, but instead of reading the actual news in the newspaper, like things that are going on in the town, he would frequently just skip to the obituaries and he would just read the obituaries. Another thing that like a lot of residents claimed about Ed is that he was just a very odd person. He would just stare at people because he didn't know any better. He would say really dark jokes. People would laugh, but he wouldn't know like that he made a joke. He was like one of those people that were funny and didn't even know it, sort of. When he would work odd jobs, there were like these groups of ladies that would come and bring food to all of the male workers that were working that day, and the women always said that like every time they brought food to Ed, they really dreaded it because he would basically just stare at them the entire time and make them super uncomfortable. The guys would try to like straighten him out and be like, ah, you're not supposed to do that, like don't look at them, that's rude. Ed just again didn't really understand the wrongness in it, because technically he wasn't hurting anyone, he was just making them very uncomfortable. So he didn't really understand that like, oh, what am I doing that's so wrong, you know? Like, I stare at a lot of people. A lot of people stare at a lot of people. Going back to his hobby in magazines and comics, this was also during World War II. Love stories, like, in the newspaper that talked about cannibalism, sex torture, and as well as I said, the obituaries. But since Ed lived in this huge house all by himself, no one really knew about his odd, dark habits. This was just kind of something that Ed did on his own time that no one was really aware about. In May of 1947, an 8-year-old by the name of Georgia Weckler actually went missing. And then over the course of the next 5 years, around 4 other people will become missing. An 8-year-old, a teenager by the name of Evelyn, and 2 men walking outside of a bar. And the 5th one being Mary Hogan. Mary Hogan, the owner of the tavern from earlier, she all of a sudden went missing. No one really had any leads either, because everyone in town loved Mary. If you ever needed like a cake to be baked, catering for a party, a drink from a bar, she was the girl that you would go to. And so since everybody loved Mary, it was really hard to find any leads or suspects. Couldn't really think of anyone that didn't like Mary or would have any ill will against her. How Mary was actually discovered missing is that one day someone actually walked into the tavern just to like get ice cream. All over the floor were bullets and blood stains. So immediately when this person saw that, they called the police. But when they looked all around, Mary was nowhere to be found, and that is when they declared Mary as missing. A while goes by of Mary being missing and no one knows where she's at, but people are still going to the tavern because there are other employees that work there. One day, all of the guys at the tavern were just talking, and one of them made a comment of like, oh, I wonder where Mary is. And Ed replies to the guy and says, oh, Mary's not missing. She's back at my farmhouse. And everyone just kind of laughed. As I said, Ed was the type of guy that like made really weird jokes. So people just kind of took jokes like that as like dark humor, sort of. It happened once before. The day before Christmas, Mary was, you know, working in the tavern, and Ed came up behind Mary and took off her apron and said, "Go home, Mary, enjoy your Christmas because it might be your last." Again, he started laughing when he said that. So a lot of people saw it as funny, like, "Oh, live every day like it's your last," sort of thing. Like, "Go have fun, Mary." People had like really dark humor back then. Obviously, this was like during World War II. A lot of people just kind of coped with kind of feeling better through humor. So when Ed made this joke about her being back at his farmhouse, no one took it seriously. November 16th, 1957, the town was having its annual 9-day deer hunt. So basically for 9 days, all of the men in the town would go out and competitively hunt deer. You could come back home if you wanted, but a lot of people just camped out there. It was all of the men in town. So the only people that were in town were the women, except for Ed. Ed was not really the type of person to hunt. Ed just kind of hung back and didn't really do much. The men would frequently come back into town for things like food and supplies. One day, a man came back into town and went to the hardware store to pick up some more camping gear. When he went to go open up the hardware store door, it was locked, which was really, really odd because the hardware store was never locked and it was owned by a woman named Bernice. Later on that day at around 5 p.m., the son of Bernice had a key to the hardware store. So he was like, "That's odd that it's locked because it's never locked." He unlocks the door, and when he walks in, he sees blood all over the floor and the place is in a complete disarray. He calls the police, examine the area, and they examine the receipt books. They didn't have, like, you know, the printed receipts how you have now. Someone had to physically write out what you bought and at what cost and to give it to you. The last person to buy something was a person buying a gallon of antifreeze. When the son read this from the receipt book, he knew exactly who was the last person to see Bernice, and it was Ed. The son was telling the police that the day before, Ed had come into the shop to ask how much antifreeze would cost, but since he didn't have money at the time, he said that he would come back tomorrow and buy antifreeze. So he's assuming that he did come back and that was the last person to see Bernice. They were on the search for Ed because Ed being the last person to see her, maybe he knows some information on where Bernice had gone. Half of the police force went all around town trying to find Ed, and the other half of the police force went to his house to check to see if he was at his house. The police force ended up finding Ed in one of the local shops and immediately brought him into custody for questioning. What they found at Ed's farmhouse is extremely graphic, so I just want to give someone just hopped in the shower. Sorry about that. But warning before I talk about what the police found in his house. So if you are the type of person to have an upset stomach or a sensitive stomach to very graphic descriptions, I would skip to this time frame when I'm done talking about the evidence found in the house. If you, you know, want to stick along, just be aware that it does get extremely graphic. They walk into the house and immediately the whole place is a mess. As I said, for the past few years has only been keeping himself to the kitchen and his bedroom. They describe it to be very dark and there were things all over the floor. So since it was so dark, the police were going in there with flashlights. All of a sudden, one of the police officers feel something brush against his shoulder, like something was hanging from the ceiling. And when he flashes his flashlight over his shoulder to see what it was, there laid the body of Bernice hanging by her feet upside down. Not only was her body hanging upside down from the ceiling, Bernice was also decapitated, hollowed out, gutted, and cleaned. Immediately when officers saw that, they all just ran outside and threw up. They needed a break. They needed a moment to collect themselves because this was the type of town that would keep their hardware store open 24/7, like just unlocked. So that's how you know that like nothing ever went on in this town. So to see this horrific of a scene, it was just very, very foreign to everyone. So eventually they had to go back into the house because they needed to, you know, see what else was in there, how many more bodies were in there. So when they went back in there and they investigated the area, they found 4 to 5 yellow teeth dentures just like laying on coffee tables as decoration. They also found magazine clippings hanging up on the wall, various reports in the newspaper talking about cannibalism, grave robbings, various obituaries. They also found a jar of chewed up chewing gum lying by his bedside table. Investigators don't really know if this was his chewing gum or someone else's, or maybe just some that he found. Bernice's intestines was just wrapped up in a big men's suit, as well as Bernice's heart in a plastic bag in front of the stove. So a lot of people were thinking that maybe he was about to cook the heart to eat it because he took a very big fascination in cannibalism. Everything else from moving forward, I'm just gonna read straight from my notes so I don't get anything wrong. They found a burlap sack that steamed when opened, and inside was Bernice's head. So a lot of people were assuming that steam was due to, like, you know, when you open up something cold and a lot of steam comes out. He was keeping the head frozen to preserve it for longer. There was also the head had nails inside of the ears, and the nails were bent upwards like hooks, and there was rope around the nails. So if there was rope, he could hang up the head like decoration. My god. They also found a plastic bag with hair, and when they went to go pull on the hair to see if it was just a bag full of hair, attached to the hair was a face, just skin. And when the police took a closer look at this face, they identified the woman to be Mary Hogan. Remember when I was saying that Ed would walk into the tavern and he just thought that Mary was so beautiful? He thought that she was so beautiful to the point where he kidnapped her and took her face off so he could look at it whenever he wanted. Found 4 chairs with human flesh upholstery. They found lampshades with human skins and faces. So he would take lampshades and upholster human flesh and various faces onto the lamps. They found whole human bones in a big basket, which the basket was also upholstered with real human flesh. Multiple human skulls on display for decor. So some of the skulls he would cut off the tops and use as bowls. He had a shoebox filled with 9 women genitals, and one of the genitals in particular was painted silver with a red bow on top. A box with 4 noses and a cereal box full of different types of head skin. A coffee table with human shin bones as the legs of it, and lips sewn onto the curtains. Oh my god, do I wish that was it. They also found female fingernails and faces that Ed would dress up in. Took these women's bodies, their skins, and made them into clothing, such as a waistcoat he made out of a human woman body, even still with the breasts attached. He also also made gloves, belts, leggings, and other various clothes. When Ed was like asked about this later on of like, why did he keep all of these women's bodies and make them into clothes? He said that sometimes he would take his big trench coat that had the breast attached to it. He would put on this coat, put on like the leggings that he made out of female skin. He would put on a face of his choosing and one of the female genitals and just look at himself in the mirror for hours and envision himself as a woman or just adore himself because, as I said, Ed grew up very sheltered, so the only body that he was ever familiar with was his own, and that was a male body. So the female body just intrigued him so much, but it intrigued him so much to where it got very violent. In the beginning, how Ed was supposed to be a girl. The mom was praying and praying that she would have a girl, and then Ed pops out a man. Been so many occasions where the mom, being as abusive as she was, would make it very known to Ed that he was in fact supposed to be a girl, and she was very mad at him for not being a girl. After all of that, thank God, that is the end of it. And there's honestly so much more that was found in that house, but I would just be sitting here forever if I just went through the list of so many different things that they found. This story grew nationwide. It was not just in Wisconsin. Everybody was talking about this story all over the world, all over like America. Even today, like, it's such an odd, crazy story. It's not even like, oh, well, the times were different back then, so people were just freaking out. Like, girl, it's 2021 and I'm freaking out about this still. Like, it's just so intense, and it's something that like nobody had ever seen before. When he was brought into custody, his immediate response was just to deny, pretend that he had nothing to do with it, even though they had found so much evidence into his house. He said the only way he would talk is if he was able to get a slice of apple pie with cheese on top. And so the police did just that. They got him a piece of apple pie with a slice of cheese on top, and when he was done eating it, he was glad to answer any questions that the police had for him. He confesses that he actually only killed around two people, Mary and Bernice, but a lot of like the human skin that they found were the skin of already dead people. So remember how I said that he would frequently read in the obituaries? Basically, the reason why he would read the obituaries all the time is that he would wait for a middle-aged woman, someone that kind of looked like his mother, to pass away. And then when they did, he would go out to their gravesite and grave rob them, like the whole entire body, and bring them back to the farmhouse. The police were kind of stumped because they were like, okay, well, he did commit a crime, but it wasn't murder because the person was already dead to begin with, and grave robbing is a crime. It was very difficult on what to exactly charge him with. And so, to prove that he in fact did these things and he wasn't just like, you know, trying to, oh, I didn't kill anyone, they were already dead. To further prove that they were in fact dead, he took the police to two specific grave sites that he did grave rob. And when the police were able to dig up both grave sites, they opened up the coffin, and in fact, yes, the bodies were gone. He said that he had grave robbed about 10 different graves and had stole 10 different bodies, 9 female genitals, and all these different like skins for all of his decor and clothing. Although he did kill all of these women, he does in fact deny anything associated with cannibalism and necrophilia. He said the only reason he would use the bodies is for their skin. And that was it, which the police did believe because they ran tests on Ed to see if he had any like viruses or anything that has to do with necrophilia, and he came back clean for everything. And then as far as the cannibalism, they looked into his house, and although he had a bunch of articles pertaining to cannibalism, they didn't find any evidence that would prove that he actually went through with it. The only evidence that they really found was the heart, Bernice's heart, in front front of the stove as if he was planning on doing it, but since he didn't follow through with it, he wasn't charged with it. Remember like a little while ago when I mentioned that 8-year-old, the teenager, the two men that went missing? He was only responsible for Mary. They tried looking into and asking Ed about the other people, but Ed kind of just denied any association with them, which again, the police believed because he tended to only go for middle-aged women when it came to his victims. And so having like a young girl, such as an 8-year-old or a teenager, or even trying to take down two men at the same time, like coming out of a bar, they kind of believed Ed when he said that he was innocent in this regard. He wasn't charged with any of those disappearances except for Mary's. After his questioning, he was then sent to a mental hospital for questioning to see if he was eligible to receive the insanity plea. After the examination, he was diagnosed with schizophrenic personality with neurotic manifestations. So because of that, at his actual court date, he was then sentenced not guilty for reasons of insanity. From there, he was not sent to a prison, but instead sent to a mental hospital. He was known in the town for being a very big hard worker, and that same behavior followed when he was in the mental institution. A lot of the doctors would describe Ed to be sort of a model patient. He never caused any problems for anyone. He kept to himself. He did what he was supposed to, and he was actually the only patient that was not on medications, but he also was in fact the only patient that was not allowed any contact to the outside world. He was allowed no visitors, no interviews from the press, basically just sat there in isolation, which that's kind of what he had been doing his whole life, so it really wasn't like that big of a change for him. Although he wasn't able to get any outside contact from people, he was getting a lot of letters, specifically love letters. He was receiving tons of love letters from girls saying that he was like super artistic for what he did, and the only reason he did what he did is because he was just misunderstood. He didn't know any better. He wasn't familiar with the outside world. And some people just saw that like childhood isolation as like kind of sweet. And then you think about like, oh yeah, but he also skinned a woman and made her body into a trench coat. And then you kind of lose sight of that. But yeah, he was receiving tons of love letters from like all these different women. About 10 years later, he was able to become retried, but he was just sent right back to the mental hospital because they deemed him as not fully well yet. While he was in the mental hospital, he needed to do something with all of Ed's things, so they decided to auction it off, specifically like his farmhouse, and oh my god, no, not all of the decor and stuff like that. That would be really dark. Sold the human flesh lampshades. Oh my god, no. No, 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 no. It was just the house. It was just the house and his car and like things like that. None of that. They ended up selling his farmhouse, but the day before the auctioning, it actually burnt down, which the town was like kind of happy with. They were like, yeah, burn that thing down. Like, we do not want that. Like, who would want to buy that, first of all? Kind of, you know, a heroic thing that someone burnt that thing down. But his car was then auctioned off and sold to a man who worked in a circus. And basically, this man would charge 20 cents for people to look at the car, like look inside, see what was going on in there. And on the first day of this viewing, this person got around 2,000 people lined up for the first viewing, 20 cents a person, to just look at his car. And as I said, this was a nationwide story. Everyone was talking about it, so people were really excited just to see like a little glimpse into this man's life. On July 26th of 1984, Ed had actually passed away at the age of 77 due to lung cancer. So he passed away in the hospital, and that's basically where the story concludes. Super ironically, he was actually buried in the same graveyard that he used to grave rob at.
And also, another thing is that Ed actually in the beginning had a headstone with like his name and his dates on there, but in 1993, someone actually stole the headstone, and even today, there is no headstone that lies for Ed. There was a lot of like people protesting that, again, like I said, that really dark fact of him being buried in the same graveyard that he actually used to grave rob at. He took so many innocent lives while he was alive. Even after like people were dead, he stole the bodies of like innocent people. And so now when families visit their mother or their grandmother, the body isn't even there. They just thought it wasn't fair for that horrendous of a person that stole so many innocent lives to have like a headstone or even to be remembered was not right. So they stole it. And even to this day, there's no headstone for him.
He was buried in between his mother and his brother, and that's where he still stays today. As for today, this story has inspired so many big movies, such as Norman Bates in Psycho, Leatherface in Texas Chainsaw Massacre, Buffalo Bill from Silence of the Lambs, and Hannibal Lecter in Hannibal. And there are so many more than that as well. This story is just so graphic and traumatizing. It's terrifying. It is. And that's why these terrifying subjects inspire terrifying movies. A lot of people could say that maybe he did what he did because of his like abusive childhood, but Henry had the same exact childhood and he turned out differently. So maybe it really just was an Ed thing, or maybe Ed just didn't really understand what was socially acceptable and what wasn't. When he would say his like dark humored jokes, he was actually telling the truth, but people would laugh because he assumes that like everyone does it.
And also, it didn't really help that Ed kept on finding all of these like newspaper articles and different books upon cannibalism. In his head, he was like, oh, if all these other people are grave robbing, then why is it wrong that I also grave rob, when like obviously people do it all the time? Yes, people do it, but that doesn't make it right. But in his head, he just kind of thought like, well, if it was wrong, then why do people do it? He didn't really understand it. He just thought like, oh, if people are writing about cannibalism, it's probably like a known thing or something.
So yeah, that is the story of Ed Gein. I hope you guys found this very, very interesting. This happened in the 1950s. So that means if any of the victims that he had kids, those kids are probably still alive today. And I hope they are doing as well as they can be. I don't know. I'm kind of playing ping pong in my brain right now of like, Hailey, what he did was bad. What are you talking about? Like, I'm glad that he was able to rot before he died because he deserves it. He caused so much pain to so many people. But then on the other side, it's like, hey, but Hailey, he had such like a traumatic childhood and he had no connection to the outside world. So he just kind of did whatever he thought what was socially acceptable, but turned out wasn't socially acceptable. But who's going to tell him? No one. And how was he going to find out? Through no one. So it was just him and his brain. And then I go back and I'm like, but Hailey, all those victims, like, they obviously are probably still traumatized even to this day and are glad that he died in that mental hospital. What he did was wrong. No matter what way you look at it, it was wrong. And there are so many people that grow up in like abusive households and turn out completely fine. Like, I feel like if Henry survived that household, he would have turned out completely fine. That's that. Happy Halloween, even though it's not Halloween for you. It's like beginning of November. Do you guys want to know what I'm going to be? I'll show you my costume. This is my costume. I am the mother from Rapunzel. I decided to dress up as the mother from Rapunzel. I had like a black curly wig. I have that dress and it's going to look great. Yeah, I didn't post last week. Dun dun dun. Sorry about that. How would you guys feel? If you're still listening, how would you guys feel about me posting different content on this channel? Like, I'll still post true crime, but I also just don't want to do like true crime and like sit down videos forever. I kind of want to start changing my content up a little bit. I still want to do like spooky, scary stuff, but I kind of want to travel with it. And if I do that, it's going to take me a really long time to edit. So that means I probably won't be sticking to my Friday schedule anymore. I'll be posting once a week, but just whenever I'm done with the video that week. I wish I was able to do something a little bit more creatively challenging rather than just kind of sitting here doing my makeup and speaking. Traveling vlogs or regular like sit down videos where I don't do my makeup. makeup, but I still talk about, you know, random subjects. I've always wanted to create more creative content, but I feel like this type of style of content, like, it's just something that I do because I like to do it, but it's not fulfilling me 100% creatively anymore. So how would you guys feel with that shift in content? Kind of got serious for a minute. Sorry about that. But I don't know. I just want to hear your genuine thoughts about if I did something like that. And don't worry, it won't be like, you know, regular, like, hey guys, I'm in this place. Now I'm in the hotel in this place. Now I'm eating food in this place. It's gonna be very visually pleasing aesthetic and not like the type of aesthetic where it's just like no copyright aesthetic music and it's like a little ukulele behind like me cutting carrots on a counter and like 1980s Parisian movie. If you guys have ever seen like an 80s Parisian European movie, like a Wes Anderson sort of thing, ugh, I think that's so cool. So yeah, what would you guys feel if I did something different like that? And if you're still listening, then your opinion is the only one that matters. As for that, that is today's video. I really hope you guys enjoyed it. And if you did, make sure to give it a big thumbs up and subscribe. And if you want to follow me on any of my socials, such as my Instagram, that will be linked down below, as well as my PO box if you want to send me anything. And also, as well as the products that I use on my face. So if you're like, girl, what is that lip? What is that shadow? That will be linked down below. I also went for like a really cool Miley Cyrus sort of thing. Miley Cyrus, she's done this makeup look before. Yes, I did my wall. I messed around with my wall. I don't have anything up there, I know. Everything is changing. I'm changing around my content, I'm changing around my wall. Who knows, maybe I'll dye my hair. I won't dye my hair. Don't worry. I actually want to grow out my hair super long before I dye it. So we got some time being this like, I don't even know what my hair color is. Like a ginger dirty blonde, I guess. And yeah, I hope you guys enjoyed. Dang, I forget to post one Friday and then I just mess up my whole entire traditions. So with that being said, do something that makes you happy today.